welcome back. And if you joined us late today, I'm visiting with a very special person, Lisa Noelle Babbage. And she is a teacher and an author, and she's based in the Atlanta area. And she's come over here to share with us today. She's written several books, and now she teaches on the university level.
I do.
I love your name, Lisa Noelle. That's just, it's kind of musical. That's lovely.
Well, thank you. I wish I was musically inclined.
But you're talking about what does it look like to talk about this campaign of choosing love? And it doesn't cost us anything. This is, everybody worries about shopping and all this. The one thing we can give that costs nothing is love.
And you know, it's the one thing that is a one size fits all.
Yeah.
You know, in many cases, we interact with people and we don't even connect with them in any way, shape, or form. Because I think in many ways, stress causes us to forget how easy it is to love. You know, an animal can approach you and something changes in your heart. But we don't always give that same reaction to others that we come in contact with other human beings. So I Choose Love campaign is a way to spark that conversation amongst the people that we interact with, people in our communities.
Okay, so when you choose love, what do you mean? What does it mean to you?
The first thing that choosing love means is to listen. You can listen with your ears or you can listen with your heart. And there are many people that we will come in contact with that we don't have any personal connection with. And we make assumptions about them based on the way they act, how they look, where they live, or what they do for a living. But when you listen to that individual with your heart, you're putting yourself, you're positioning yourself in a way that you can actually share love. It could be a smile, as you said. It could be a handshake or holding the door, or it could be something more. But you actually position yourself to see where that conversation can go.
Okay, so now that brings you to when you were in the classroom with children. Let's talk about that.
It's very interesting. I knew I was in the time frame of transitioning out of early education. And my last classroom was one of my most challenging ones, not just because I was ready to go, but because the group of students that I had was unlike any other group I ever experienced. It was a classroom of over 30 fifth graders.
Fifth grade.
35th graders.
You had your hands full in the very beginning.
I did. And those students represented 23 different countries.
Oh, my goodness.
And I pretty much was alone in that classroom. I had some support teachers.
So this was like an international classroom.
It was. But it was just a public school that happened to receive international students.
Oh.
And that public school, a very large public school, opened my eyes to the challenges that some teachers have because their classrooms are so international. And I had not experienced it to that degree in my prior years of teaching.
So you had all these kids from various places, and you were trying to bring them all together to learn.
Right. And do you know what I had to do? I had to listen with my heart. Because in the case of two or three of them, they barely spoke English. And I had to find a way to bridge all of those cultures while teaching a curriculum.
That is an unbelievable.
It is. It is.
And you were able to do it.
Well, there are some successes and there are some not so successes. As my former fifth grade teacher who wrote the foreword to Not So Cookie Cutter Kids indicated, this academic memoir is transparent. There were some instances where it was stellar and others not so much.
So now you are teaching no longer children, but adults.
Teaching young adults at Southeastern University at a remote location. But I'm really dedicating the bulk of my time to writing because I find that the written word reaches far more people than I could reach in a single day. So I'm promoting all of those tender nuggets that I've garnered over the years on the written page.
Okay. So what does this look like when we just live our everyday lives, going to the grocery, doing the things that we baking and cleaning up the house and getting ready for the holidays and all the things we do, if we don't incorporate our heart into it and love into it, we're missing the boat.
Absolutely. And it doesn't matter what time of year it is, you will always find something to distract you. And I believe one thing that we don't really experience in our modern fast-paced world is a moment of self-reflection. I believe that self-reflection is a way that we can do our own heart check.
I love that. Do our own heart check. And we rush around every day and we don't think about it.
We don't think about it. We take every breath for granted because we're busy and we have things to do. But when you take the time to self-reflect and check on the position of your own heart, it really drives how you interact with other people. And that's how you can choose love, changing the way you interact with other people.
And that's how we can change our homes and our neighborhoods and our schools and our churches.
It's contagious. And it's the one thing, the one greatest thing, because as you said, it's free, that we can always do.
So this season of the year, let's choose love. The greatest gift in the world, and it's free.
It's free.
It costs us nothing to open the door from someone, to call someone, are you okay?
Right.
Little simple things.
Offering that kind word, just having an empathetic ear. It's amazing what someone will tell you when you listen. And many people just need to have a personal contact with someone else. And they need to feel that you're open and receptive to actually hearing, not with your ears, but with your heart, what they want to share.
Okay. Now, your books are available.
Yes, ma'am.
And you brought two here that you've written.
Believe it or not, I have written 23 books.
Oh, my.
Yes. And, my childhood dream was to be an author.
All right.
But it wasn't until this year that I embraced that dream and started having my books published, and they're available on Amazon.
Okay, and the ones we have here, Not So Cookie Cutter Kids. This would be a good help for any parent and teacher or anybody who's interested in young people.
Absolutely. And as I said, there's a curriculum that accompanies that, right, also available online.
And then the other one is 333 Miracles, a testimony. This is your story.
It is. It's a story of hope. So it is encouraging to anyone who puts their hand to it. And I've been told it's a very easy read.
Okay. So now, she's of the many books, she only brought two today. So
I'm sorry.
But that's okay. Maybe you'll come back. But she's a teacher with 18 years of experience and now teaches at the university level. And I Choose Love campaign.
Yes.
If we could all, beginning right now, latch onto this and make it a campaign that we could carry each day into the new year, we could change ourselves, we could change the people around us, our neighborhoods, our schools, our churches.
Going to the website, ichooselovecampaign.org, people can sign the petition. They can learn more from the resources that are available. They can join our newsletter and hear articles about all the people I interview and the stories we tell. They can even sponsor their own billboard.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm amazed at all I've just met her before we sat down here. And it's amazing the things that you have brought to the public. And I hope people will. I'll keep the information here if you didn't get it. But Lisa Noel Babich.
Yes.
From Atlanta.
From Atlanta.
I hope you will come back.
Most definitely.
And I hope that you will be able to go forward with the things that you're trying to promote.
Well, I have found myself sold out to the idea that love is the way that our nation can really come together.
All right. Our nation and our world. Love. And it's all free. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Peggy.
And wherever you are, stay happy and remember to smile. We'll see you next time.